Toast. Today's Stop Feel Me is Bubba Boxer Top Noon Bubba Boxer 50. We're going to start on 49B around seven lines from the bottom. Today's Stop Feel Me is dedicated for Shemira for the Chayalim, Hatzalah for the Shvuyim, and Yeshua for Am Yisrael and his Eis Tzara. Gemara is in the middle of discussing whether or not a woman can establish a chazakah. Our husband can establish a chazakah by using his wife's property. And the implication of the Gemara at this point is that no, he can't establish a chazakah because he has the rights to use her nechsei maluk. He has the rights to use her fruits of her property as part of the marriage agreement. That would imply that he can't establish a chazakah, but if he brings a proof that he has actually the rights to sell her property, then that would be acceptable. So the Gemara says, but how could that be the case? Haraya yesh, that if he has a proof that she allowed him to sell the property, the implication is that that would be acceptable proof, that if the husband brings witnesses or a document that his wife sold him the field, that that would be acceptable. But Tema, we have a question about this because we have a concept that if a woman will say, "I really didn't intend to sell it to him, but nachas ruach hasiti lebaali, I only sold it because I didn't want him to be upset at me," and that's our claim. Milu tanan, didn't we learn in the Mishnah in Gittin that lokach mina ish, that let's say a person bought property that was meshuba to the ksuba, meaning to say the wife has an automatic lien on it as part of her marriage. And a person buys this property from the man, and then he goes back and buys it from the woman with less money so that she wouldn't be able to take this ksuba from this property. Then we say mekachol batal. We say it's a canceled sale. And if the husband dies or divorces her, she can collect the real estate because we could say that she didn't really intend to sell it. Alma Amra, so we see from here that a woman is allowed to say, in a case where she sold the property, she is allowed to say, Nachas Ruach Hasiti Labali. A woman is allowed to say, "Listen, I made Nachas Ruach for my husband," meaning to say, "I didn't really want to sell my property that I have the rights to in the ksuba. I just did it to make my husband happy." So here too, a woman could claim that. So how could the husband have the right to sell it? So Gemara says, so why do we say that if the husband brings proof that his wife sold it to him, it's acceptable? Why can't she just claim, "Listen, I just did it for my husband"? Mara says, "No, didn't we learn about this? The explanation of that Mishnah and Begitin that she can claim in the case of where she sold the rights to the property that was owned that was meshubat to her ksuba." We learned about it that the woman could say, "Amar Rav Bar Afuna, Sados." That Mishnah is only talking about a case where it's referring where do we say that the sale does not apply? By those three fields that are going to be explained later on, meaning those three specific categories of fields. Achas Shekasa, but it doesn't apply to one of the three cases. Is it's a field that he was meshubad to her from the ksuba, and he said specifically, "This is a field that's your ksuba," and she's relying upon that more than other fields. So even if she writes that, even if she writes that she's selling it, we say she didn't really intend to sell it. V'achas sheyichad la b'ksuba. So one is that he specifically writes in the ksuba, and one is that he told her about that orally that she could collect from the ksuba, and v'achas shechnisa, and the third type of field is that she brought it with her from her father's house. So those three cases, that's where we say she can't say nacha, she can claim nachas ruach, and she didn't intend to sell it. And that those three cases, lemutimai, what cases is it excluding? If you want to explain that it's excluding the case of all other assets of the husband, that if she sold her lien on them to the one that bought them from the husband, meaning to say that she can't collect it from her ksuba. She that those she can't say nachas ruach hasita lebaal. You can say that because if with these fields, even though she has a special relationship with them, she's able to say, I just did it to make my husband happy so that he doesn't get upset with me. Kol shekein davila eva for sure. For sure, if she doesn't agree to sell those fields, which she doesn't have any special relationship, for sure we could say she could claim nachas ruach hasita lebaal. So when are we saying she can't claim nachas ruach hasita lebaal? So. Husband could say, listen, the reason why you're not selling it, it's because you intend to divorce me or you're expecting me to die. Or so that the husband could say, oh, you're thinking about divorce or you're thinking about my death. So it's coming to exclude a case of where the husband wants to sell the assets that he has the rights to the fruits. That under those case, in that case, the woman cannot say, I just did it to keep my husband happy because they're mine, and she could always refuse the people. She could always refuse to sell them. That's her rights; those are hers. So that's how the Gemara answers that question. Gemara asks another question that, basically, from the implication of the Mishnah, which is, and we're on 50A, around 5 months on the top, that if the husband will bring proof for a document. Then it's a valid sale. Meaning, say, you can't bring a chazaka, but if he brings witnesses or a shtar, it's a valid sale. So the Gemara says, "Amar Amemar Ish veIsha shemachro b'nechzei malug." Meaning to say, a Amemar has a statement that if a man or a woman sold their nechzei malug, sold this property where the husband is entitled to the fruits and the woman keeps the principal, it doesn't apply at all. So why do we say that if the implication of our Mishnah is really a question on a Amemar, the implication of our Mishnah is that the sale is valid if he has proof or witnesses. But in this case, we're saying it's not valid. So the Gemara says, so it's a question on a Amemar. So, Kiyin Mar Da Amemar, when did a Amemar say this? Eche dezabin iu umis, and asya iu umavka. So the Gemara says it applies in a case where the husband sold the field and then died, and then the woman came. And she takes the field away from the purchasers. Or inami zabna'i, or she sold the field umesa, and then she died. So even though when she died, she no longer had the rights to the fruits, we could say, we might have said that he doesn't inherit her because she sold this portion while he was still alive. Nevertheless, we say, asihi umapik. We're going to say that he comes along, and the husband comes along and takes away the field from the purchasers, b'tekanta d'rabbanan, meaning to say, as a tekana of the Rabbanan, because Rabbi Yossi bar Chanina, the Amar Rabbi Yossi bar Chanina, b'usha eskino, then in usha they instituted in order to preserve the peace of the marriage, ha'isha shemachra b'nechzei b'lug, gabal motzi mi'ado l'kuchos, that the husband can take it back from the purchaser. I'll repeat this in a moment. But if both of them sold it to somebody else, if he sold the fruits and she sold the principal, or inami zabna'i day, or else if she sold it to her husband, zabina zabine, then the sale is a valid sale, and she can't claim I did it for the sake of my husband, because she those she doesn't care about. And so therefore our Mishnah is saying that if the husband brings a proof in those cases, in a case where they both sold it, or else she sold it to him, it's valid. But where he sold it without her knowledge, or she sold it without his knowledge, then we're going to say it's not a valid sale. But if they did it together, that's what our Mishnah is saying. Or if she sold it to him, then it's a valid sale. That's what our Mishnah is saying, and that's why it's not a question for our Mamer. He buys Zamer. Alternatively, we could say a Mamer is saying that they don't intend to sell it at all, that they're not allowed to sell it at all. And even if a person bought it from the man and then bought it from the woman, it's not going to work. And for sure, if the wife sold it to the husband, it doesn't work. And if that's the case, how do we understand what a Mamer is saying? Because from our Mishnah, it's saying that it can sell it. So we're going to say, Amemar da Amar Rebbe Elazar. Amemar holds like Rebbe Elazar, who says that who argues with Rabbanan, and our Mishnah is like the Rabbanan. Now, going back, why did they institute this takana that if a woman who sells her nichsei malug and then she dies, that the husband has the right to take it back from the purchasers? So the Gemara in Baba Kama says so that in order to, that there should not be enmity between the husband and wife, and so that's the whole purpose of it. It says the Gemara. The Tanya, where are we going to see this position of Rabbi Elazar? We learn it as follows. Again, what does Rabbi Elazar say? The Rabbanan say that if he brings proof, it's a valid sale. Whereas Amemer is holding like Rabbi Elazar says that even with proof, it's not a valid sale if the wife sells it to the husband or if they both sell it together. The Tanya, Mochar as Avdo. Learning in the Brice, if somebody sells his slave, Upasak Imo Yisham Shenu. So Reuben sells the slave to Shimon, and Reuben says, listen, I have the rights to use it for additional 30 days. Basically, Reuben is entitled to the labor of the slave, and Shimon owns the slave. So it's a case of, like we said, Kenyan Peros and Kenyan Aguv. So Reuben sells the slave, but he has the right to use it. So he has the right to the Peros. Rabbi Meir says, Harishon Yeshno Bedin Yom. So what is this teaching there? Rabbi Meir says there's halacha that if you kill your Eved Kenani, if this happens, a man strikes his Eved Kenani and kills the Eved Kenani, that he's chayav misa, but he's liable for death. But if this Eved Kenani lives a day or 2 days, yom o yomayim, then we're going to say under those circumstances. If meaning to say, if the slave lives at that point a day or 2 days, then the slave is not going to be killed. It doesn't mean the it means the Gemara discusses elsewhere why it says Yom HaYomayim means it's a 24-hour period. Meaning to say, if it's a 24-hour period, then the owner is not chayav misa for striking the slave. So basically, that's the background. So our mayor says, who's the owner of this slave? The one who sold the slave, who's entitled to the kinyan apero. So he's going to be considered the owner of the slave. And so therefore, he gets the exemption of yom el yomayim, neshehu tachtav, because since he has the peros, so the slave is under his domain. Where the second one is not under the law of Yom HaYomayim, because he's not under his presence. So we see from here that Ramirez has a position. Kenyan Ramirez has a position. Whoever has the fruits, they're going to be considered like they own the essence of the entity. And so therefore, whoever owns the labor owns the slave. And also, the woman in this case, she owns the fruit. So, excuse me, the man in this case, he owns the fruit. So he's like he owns a slave. He owns the property. Whereas Rabbi Yehuda says, Hashenu, Hasheni Yeshno Bedin Yom HaYomayim, Rabbi Yehuda says, the second one, the guy who has the Kinyan Aguf, the guy who owns the property, or in this case, the slave, he has the law of Yom HaYomayim, Neshu Kaspo, because it's his entity. He owns it. Harishon Eino Bedin Yom HaYomayim, the first one doesn't have it. Because he's not considered his money. So we see from here, according to Rabbi Yehuda, that the one who owns the fruits, in this case, the first owner, is not going to be considered like they own the essence of the entity. Whereas Rabbi Yehuda says, Rabbi Yehuda says, both of them are included in this law of Yom O Yomayim, meaning to say that if you own either Kenyan Peros or Kenyan Aguf, it's considered like you're the owner. Because one of them is because he has the right to the Kenyan Peros, and the one who owns the one who bought it is because he owns the Kaspo. And so therefore, Rabbi Yossi says that they both have the right to for the law of Yom HaYomayim. And since Misafkei Kinyan Paris Kinyan Aguf Dami Ilav Kinyan Paris Dami, since we're not sure if Kinyan Paris is or Kinyan Aguf Dami, we're not sure who's the real owner. So therefore, we're not going to kill the master here because whoever struck him down, because safek nefashos lahakil. When it comes to a case of a doubt of a life, we're going to be lenient, and so therefore we're not going to kill him, and so we're therefore not going to execute the master under these circumstances. Whereas Rebbe Lazar is of the position, shneim ein b'din yom yomayim. Neither one is going to get the law of yom yomayim. Neither one gets that exemption. Zelafi sheino tachav, zelafi sheino taspa. One because he doesn't have, he's not working for him right then. He doesn't have the paris, and the other one because he already sold him. The second one purchased him, and so we see from here. Va'amarav, amai taimad Rebbe Lazar. So Rava says, what's the reasoning for Rebbe Lazar, who says that both of them are going to be liable for death here, both masters, the Amar Kra, because it says, Ach im yom o yomayim yamod lo yukam ki kas bohu. Then there shall be no, and then there should not be any avenging there, because he is his money. So it means to say, if the slave will stand up in those 24 hours, after the 24 hours and then die, then we're not going to take vengeance on the master, because the slave is his kesef. So we see from here, kasbo hamiyuchad lo. So says Rava, the pasuk tells us that has to be his specific money. And if you don't own both, if you don't own Kenyan Paris and Kenyan Aguf, you're not going to be considered like you're the real owner. And this is going to be. And if you're not the real owner, you can't sell it. And therefore, this is the source for Maimer's position that you cannot sell, that the husband or wife, neither of them has the right to sell the property, because neither one is considered the full owner. And so therefore, they can't sell it. So the Gemara says, but is it really the case? So the point is that since a husband and wife, neither one of them really is the owner, they can't sell it. But where there's partners, Tosfos says, and therefore the partners, both of them are basically owning a portion of the guf and a portion of the peros, then each one could sell their portion, and that would be okay. That would be okay. So now we go on. The Gemara says, "Vo ish chazaka b'nechzei ishto." It said in our Mishnah that a man does not have a chazaka in the possessions of his wife, and as a result of this, she does not need to object if he's there, and because he can't establish a chazaka. The Gemara says, "Is this really the case?" From Rav Sheshes ish tzricho, that if a man has a chazaka on her property, let's say he's using her property, which she's entitled to the fruit, she has to object, because since somebody else has a chazak in her assets, since he has a chazakah, she's going to lose it. So the Gemara says, no. How does Rav Sheshes explain the fact that he contradicts our Mishnah? Come on. Who do you want to say? You, Ema. If you want to say, Be'acher. If you want to say that she needs to make the objection, meaning say, Be'man. Who are we talking about? Who's Rav Sheshes talking about when it says that she needs to object? If you want to say ba'acher, that it's talking about a case where it's not her husband. No, she doesn't need to object. You can't make a chazak on a married woman's property, because she could say, no, the reason why I didn't object was because it was my husband's job to object. Allah must be the Rav Sheshes talking about our husband. And we say there that she does need to object. And this is a refutation of our Mishnah. So Amarav Olam Babal. Rava says, we're talking about objecting. Yes, we're talking about our husband. But there is one case, even though our Mishnah says he doesn't get a chazaka, there is a case where he does get a chazaka, kugon shechafar ba'bar shechon amaris, where he's basically destroying the property, he's digging ditches there. And so therefore, under those circumstances, since he's going beyond what his normal rights are, she would need to object. Mar says, v'amrav nachon arav arvua, ein chazaka u'nezikin. But why does she need to object? Why didn't we say earlier that you can't establish a chazakah for damages? Meaning to say that if somebody's damaging the field by digging it, even if he does it for 3 years, He can't say, oh, it's proof that I have a chazaka because she should have objected. But didn't we say that the husband could say, didn't we say that the other person could say, no, I didn't object now, but I didn't object then, but I'm objecting now. So Gemara says, Ema ain din chazaka in hazaka. No, we should say that he does not, that meaning to say, maybe it means ain din chazaka in hazaka. No, if it's damaging, the law of chazaka doesn't take a place after 3 years, but it happens immediately, just the opposite. Ain din chazaka in, not that there's no chazaka, that there's no law of chazaka for nezikin. Or alternatively, we could go in the opposite direction. Like we said earlier, he buys same out of law. That didn't we learn about this? That Rav Mari says, Bakutra, Rav Zvid, Amar, Bebesakise. When do we say that you can't establish a chazaka through Nezikin? If it's something that's like the smoke that you don't want to live with anymore, or a bathroom, meaning to say that there's a toilet built on your property that you could say, at first I didn't mind, but now I mind. So that's where we say ain't a chazaka b'nizikin. But somebody who's destroying the property and he doesn't object, there you would establish a chazaka. So Gemara says, Gemara brings a different answer. Rav Yosef Amar Lo'olam Ba'achar. No, we're talking about Rav Shesha's statement that a woman, Rav Shesha's statement that a person can establish a chazaka against the property of a married woman is not referring to the husband, but it's referring to somebody else. Who could go in Sha'acha Mikzas Chazaka Bechaye Abal, Vesholosh Achar Misas Abal. No, we're talking about a case where she consumed prior to the property, meaning to say where the person who we're saying is establishing a Chazaka against her, he consumed part of the property while her husband was alive. And then 3 years after the husband has died. And so therefore, and he claims he purchased the field from the husband, who had in turn purchased it from his wife. And so therefore, we're going to believe him, Migudi Bai Amarle, because since he could have claimed, I bought the, because since he could have claimed, I bought the rights for the fruits from the husband his whole life. And then if the woman had died first, I would also get the field. But if the husband will die first, I'll lose it. And so therefore, he could have claimed that. And so therefore, Anazabintaminach, and so therefore I bought the field from you after he died, and I lost my contract. Kiamo nami. So since he also makes the claim that you sold it to him, and he sold it to me, that's going to be a valid chazaka. Mehemen, if he has chazaka in those 3 years, that's valid, and she would have to object. Okay, so we'll stop the recording here.